Good afternoon, everybody. This is Brother Lloyd. And as always, to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, Shabbat Shalom. I hope you have any blessed and peaceful Sabbath. Now, today we're going to spend a few minutes talking about faith and believing. We cannot emphasize anything in Scripture too much. Some people need to hear certain things over and over and over until they take root and grow. One thing to keep in mind, people, is we all have the responsibility to share the word with others. So the more you understand it, the better. So keep that in mind as you hear things over and over. Now, what is faith? Well, it's all about this. Hebrews 11:1 reads like this. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Simple enough. Substance of things you hope for, the evidence of things not seen. Simple example. You all go out of here, get in your car, and you drive wherever you have to go, and you arrive there safely to do whatever it is that you have to do, and then you turn around and reverse the process and head back home. Now, many of you don't realize that you did a lot of this in faith. You hope that you would arrive safely to where you are going without being killed or injured in an accident, that you would be able to accomplish your task, that you would not run out of fuel, whatever, all these things would fall into place, and you also hope that you would return home safely. And these things come to pass, and it satisfies all of your faith. See, because you left home doing this in faith without any prior evidence that it was going to succeed, that none of these negative things would happen. You did that in faith. And it fulfilled itself. See, the word does the same thing with telling us and teaching us about faith. You believed it would, and eventually it did. This is faith, and this is what we do many times a day over and over. Every single one of us goes to bed every evening hoping to wake up in the morning. And most of us go to bed saying things like, I hope I hear my alarm in the morning. I hope the power doesn't go off. I hope my car starts tomorrow morning. But we do all this. We go to sleep. We wake up. We hear the alarm clock. We go out. We get in our car and start the car. And it starts. And we do all these things. And it fulfills that hope that we had. But before it happened, we didn't have prior evidence that it would happen. Now, we have history behind us that these things has happened. And that's what the word is. The word is history. There's a lot of history behind us that so many things have happened, especially through faith. Another example, history, and we actually live it every day. But people, when it comes to Scripture, they say things like, well, I don't believe in the Father, I don't believe in this, I don't have faith in that. But yet, that's how you live your life every day in everything you do. You may not acknowledge it, but that's what you're doing. Still, many people claim that they don't believe in the Heavenly Father, but they sure do have a lot of faith in something. And they just simply haven't acknowledged it. And there hasn't been the course of events or change in their life to give them cause to realize that this is of the Father, especially all the positive things that happen in their life, like waking up every day. So, I have another question. Who do the Muslims trace their lineage through? They trace their lineage through Ishmael. For those of you who don't know, who do the Jewish or Jews trace their lineage through? They trace their lineage through Isaac. And of course, his father, their father was who? Abram. Now, for the big question, who do believers trace their lineage through? I'll give you a moment. Okay, since you don't know, I will tell you. Believers trace their lineage through faith. See? That's the only thing we have, is faith. As a believer, your faith is tested every single day and at every level. Remember, the Savior said, anyone whoso or whoever believes unto him. John 5:24, it reads, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. See, we have to go on faith in so many aspects of our life as a believer. And this is just another area. But people can be very critical of those who, quote unquote, blindly believe or have blind faith, as it's referred to more often than not. But the word says to believe. He didn't say that I will give you evidence and proof, you know, to eat, put your mind at ease. He said, believe unto me, or believe unto him that sent me. So we are simply to accept his word and believe. And that's difficult for a lot of people to do. Now, to have faith and believe in something that you can't see and can only hope for takes a serious commitment. It takes a serious commitment and strength in your mind. And how do we strengthen this mind? We strengthen our mind by being in the Word. We have to be in the Word. You have to be studying. You have to be devoted to this. See, you're challenged daily by the world and by the enemy. And you will also be sometimes tested of the Father to see that you truly are faithful and believe, and that you will allow his promises to fulfill themselves as he said they would. The Father keeps all of his promises, as I always say. The word tells us that we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? Romans 8:24. For we walk what, people? We walk by faith, not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5:7. We do that in faith. We walk in faith, by faith. Now, another example. You hope that your paycheck is deposited in your bank account. Now, before it's in there, you have no evidence that it's actually in there. You have the hope that it's in there by something that you are told, just like the Father tells us. That's the only clue or indication that something's going to be. So that's the evidence that you have. But then you go to your account and you check your account, and it's there. It's no longer hope. Now it is. See, but until it was there, it was just hope. And you believed that it was because you were told it would be there, or it would be. See, with a check, you had a specific time and place to give a check on to make sure that it was. But see, with the Father, he tells us it will be, but we have to understand and accept that when it's time to be. So until then, we have to have a steadfast hope, even until our death, that what he says will come to pass. But it will come, and there will be a specific time. But just because we're not privy to that specific time right now doesn't mean it won't be, and that gives us no cause to not have hope. So we can look at it as a paycheck that the Father says will be deposited. But see, he just hasn't told us when, so we just have to hold fast to what he says and wait for when it is. But until then, it's just hope. Now, one problem that people like myself face, and though many others who teach the Word and things like that, is that there are so many that say, well, I want you to show me proof in the Scriptures. And a lot of times people often come back and say, well, show me in Scripture. I've been going through this for the past couple of weeks. Show me in the Scriptures. And then you show Scripture, and then they say, well, show me. It basically comes back and say, well, I don't show me other Scripture. It's a continual cycle. There's more to it than just continually showing Scripture upon Scripture upon Scripture. And as you find out, it doesn't just make you believe and accept what someone's teaching you, when you have to keep saying, well, I need to see more Scripture. Well, I need to see this. I need to see that. What it shows us is that this is developed by virtue of what? Studying and researching and allowing that discernment and wisdom and knowledge to take root by the power of the set-apart Spirit, or Holy Spirit, as many people like to say. But at some point, you will accept and believe because it triggers, it just clicks, because you have been doing all these things. I never say just listen to me, Because the word also says this, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. 2 Timothy 2:15. And then also in 1 Thessalonians 5:21 also says this. It says to prove all things, hold fast to that which is good. See, you have to prove all things to your own level of acceptance until your doubt is alleviated, until it becomes a belief, a total, sincere, accepting belief. Now, once you believe, it strengthens what? It strengthens your faith in the things that you hope for without needing evidence. See, we can't need evidence for everything. Some things we just have to accept, and we have to wait and see. There's a lot of things we do daily in the world. We wait and see without evidence. And then when it comes to pass, we go, okay, well, it came to pass. Well, I guess it was right. See, we do that in the world, but yet when it comes to the Father's Word, people will fight you daily and constantly on the Word. They want you to be able to prove it without a doubt to them. Tangible, hardcore proof is not always possible, people. You have to have some form of belief and acceptance in you, and you can't always come down on those that are teaching. Now, we're told to do what, people? We are told to hold fast to that which is good. And you have to understand, not any and everything is good. It has to be true, honest, just, pure, lovely, virtuous. It has to hold praise, and it has to be of good report, as we're told in Philippians 4, 8, and 9. And why are we told this? Because if we do this, if we hold on to these things, the Father says He will be with us. Philippians 4, 8, and 9. Read it. But 1 Thessalonians 5:22 turns right around and tells us to abstain from even the appearance of evil. Even the appearance of evil. So if it is not good and has even the appearance of evil, let it go without even giving thought to it. Why? I'm always going to tell you why. Why? So that you don't allow for opportunity for the flesh to become involved. And then once the flesh becomes involved, it can give cause to us to fulfill those lustful desires. Romans 13, 13 and 14. Now, if we give thought to things that are evil or sinful in their nature, this is allowing for what? It's allowing for the enemy to have an opportunity to tempt us or to give strength to a temptation or whatever it is. Example, if you like to drink, and a friend comes by and say, hey, let's go out for a drink, you are liable to say yes because you give thought to it. But see, if you're holding on to that which is good, as we're told in Philippians 4, 8, if you're just hanging on to those things and meditating on to those things, and that same friend comes by and say, hey, let's go out for a drink, you go, nah, no thanks, don't want to. See, you didn't even give thought to it. But hesitation is a point of giving thought. So we have to be careful when the enemy tries to trip us up. We have to not allow him to cause us to give thought to something and cultivate it in our mind, because once we do that, it grows into something sinister. So remember, the word says to abstain from evil. Even the appearance of anything is evil. But more importantly, it's clearly telling us to meditate and hold fast to all things which are good. And this is where we draw our strength from the Father and His Word. Until then, this is Brother Lloyd. I will meditate in thy precepts and have respect unto thy ways. Psalms 119:15. I'm out.